Hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome you today to the Word on Wednesday. We're here at Progressive Community Church International, where Pastor Curtis Whitaker is our senior pastor. Today, I'm going to bring the Word on Wednesday to you, and we'll still be in Genesis chapter 47. I'll be starting with verse 7, then go down to verse 10. And I'm not sure where I will end up based on how God has led me. So I know for sure we'll do 7 and 10 and 11. And we'll see where we go from there. Again, I want to thank you for joining. For those out on social media, we say hi today. And before we begin, I'd just like to say a brief prayer. Again, we'll be in Genesis chapter 47, starting with verse number 7. Father God, we give you thanks for this day, Lord God. We praise your name, Lord God, for how you are teaching us to study your word. You're bringing out some things in these days that were not available to us previously. And so, Father God, as you continue to reveal and give us this rhema word from your word, we feel truly blessed. We were blessed last week with such a powerful word, and I pray that today the word will be able to be heard with clarity and with understanding, so that people can understand what your word is saying to your people. So we thank you, Father, and we praise your holy name. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 We'll be starting with verse number 7. And I entitled this as I started to study. I didn't know what to title it. But it came up to be, who is this Pharaoh? Who is this Pharaoh is the title that came after a lot of study. Now, when we start in Genesis chapter 47, verse 7, I'll be reading mostly from the King James Version. So if you have your Bible, you can just follow along with me during this lesson. Genesis chapter 47, verse 7. Now, I would like to reiterate that I will not be doing verses 8 and 9. Pastor taught about that last week. And he did such a profound job on it, I do not have to go over that. If you want to know what was spoken on verses 8 and 9, you need to go to the website, to Progressive Community Church, and listen to the video. It is very powerful and very anointed. It will truly bless you. And with that, I say so be it and amen. Verse 7. And Joseph brought in Jacob, his father, and set him before Pharaoh. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh. So what happened in verse 7 is Joseph took his father right before Pharaoh, right after the brothers had achieved that they would be staying in the land of Goshen. And when we look at this passage, as I kept reading it, I realized that Jacob was not intimidated by Pharaoh. He stood before Pharaoh as a man of God with divine authority. And the first thing that he did was he blessed Pharaoh. He gave Pharaoh a blessing. Now, the blessing is not stated in our scripture. But what Jacob did was he wished him health and happiness. He prayed for his welfare, and he gave him thanks for everything that Pharaoh was doing for his family. Now, in the Targum, the Hebrew history books of these same verses, it tells us the actual prayer that Jacob gave. It says, "May it be the pleasure of the Almighty God that the waters of the Nile may be filled, and that the famine may be removed from the world in thy days." So here is Jacob as a man of God standing in front of another power, a powerful man who has authority over the land of Egypt. So you have a man of political authority, and you have a man with divine authority, and they're speaking to one another. Now, every time Jacob blessed Pharaoh, he was in divine authority, because Jacob is the patriarch of the Israelites family. But in those days, the patriarch was also the prophet of the family. So when every time it says he blessed Pharaoh, it's a divine spoken word coming from God himself through Jacob to Pharaoh. And when you go back to verse 10, it says Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from the presence of Pharaoh. So Jacob blessed Pharaoh coming in, and he blessed Pharaoh going out. Okay. Now the remarkable thing about this scripture is, in the Egyptian religion, Pharaoh was considered to be a god. He was that human personification of the Egyptian god, the sun god, the S-U-N god called Ra. So it was even remarkable. The remarkable thing is that Pharaoh allowed this man, Jacob, to give him a blessing. This is something that's very rare, for someone to bless a Pharaoh. And it was something that normally did not happen. So then we go to verse number 11 and 12, and in those two verses, it tells us that Israel takes the best of the land. So during the famine, Pharaoh has blessed Israel with the best of the land. In verse 6, it says, I'm going back to verse 6. It says, the land, when Pharaoh said, the land of Egypt is before you, and the best of the land makes our father and brethren to dwell. So he said that in verse number 6, the first part of verse, the first two parts of verse number 6. But then when we get down to verse 47, chapter 47, verse 11, excuse me, Joseph, it says, and Joseph placed his father and his brethren and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. Now, once I got to verse 11, I had a study issue. Because I realized that the land of Ramses does not happen until Moses is on the scene. During this time where Egypt is going into the land of Ramses is called the land of Goshen. Or in the Targum, it's called the Pilsum, something like that. But it is not called Ramses, because Ramses has not even been born yet. So as I looked at this scripture, the first thing I did was I looked at what other place did it mention the land of Ramses. This is the only place where it says the phrase, the land of Ramses, because it won't be called this until later on in history during the 19th dynasty of Egypt. So what that did was it made me go into history. Because I wanted to know why God allowed Moses to put the land of Ramses in this scripture. So my question became, when it mentions this land of Ramses, it's giving me some kind of historical marker to do some deep study about this passage. And I had to find out how it relates to the land, how it relates to Pharaoh, and how it relates to the nation of Israel. Not only when they came into the land, but where they would live in the land of Egypt. So as I started studying, I do have this book at home called The Timetables of History. The first thing I did was I went to this book. And as I was looking in this book, historians already knew that at some specific time in history, the Canaanites took over Egypt. And they formed a kingdom in the Delta. And when we look at the history of Egypt, if you ever have a chance to look up the history of Egypt, you will find out that from the first dynasty of Egypt to the 14th dynasty of Egypt, the kings of Egypt are called kings. They are not called pharaohs. And somewhere in the middle of the 14th dynasty of Egypt's history, there was a large influx of Canaanites into the land. And they were called Hyksos, H-K-Y-S-O-S. And they were Asiatic Semites. We would call them Palestinians today. And so they made their first appearance in the region near Goshen. And they took control of that area. They weren't in power yet, but a lot of them were there. So right in the middle of the end of the 14th dynasty, the Canaanites seized governmental control over Lower and Middle Egypt. So this marks the first time where parts of Egypt are being ruled by foreigners. And the historians also know that before the Canaanites occupied Egypt, the title of Pharaoh was not used to address the kings of Egypt. So they also tell us in history that they took over during the 14th dynasty, and now it becomes the 15th dynasty. They ruled all of Egypt. By the 16th dynasty, Egypt is split again because there's fighting among them. And then by the 17th dynasty, the Canaanites are kicked out of Egypt. So from the 17th dynasty down to the time where Moses comes to lead the Israelites out of Egypt, they're under an Egyptian king. And when we look at our Bible, when we read our Bible, we never read them saying, King of Egypt. They always say Pharaoh. So when I went to Genesis chapter 12, when there was a famine in the land, Abram, his name wasn't Abraham yet, and Sarah, went to Egypt and they had an encounter with Pharaoh. So based on scripture and history as we know it, world history as we know it, Canaanite, this Pharaoh, was a Canaanite. He was a foreigner in power in the land of Egypt. And even in verse 20, in Genesis chapter 26, there was another famine in the land during the time of Isaac. But God told Isaac, don't go to Egypt. There was a Canaanite Pharaoh governing in the land of Egypt. Even in Genesis 47, when Jacob went to Egypt and when Joseph was captured, when Joseph was sold to Potiphar, he was sold to Potiphar's officer, who was an officer of Pharaoh. Okay, so Pharaoh is the Canaanite. It's a Canaanite foreigner serving in that office. So now I'm reading all these places where it says Pharaoh. I've tried to find a place within scripture where the king of Egypt was called king, but I could not find one. So I went to world history, as I knew it. Then I decided to go to Jewish history. And the Jewish history reference I use is the book of Jasher, because it's mentioned twice in our scriptures. It's mentioned in 2 Samuel, when David was lamenting over the death of King Saul and his friend Jonathan. David is lamenting, and they said to go to Jasher, go to the book of Jasher and find out about the song of the bow. That's in the book of Jasher. Then another place where the book of Jasher is mentioned is in Joshua, when Joshua prayed and asked God to keep the sun up so they could keep fighting. There's a detailed description of that also in the book of Jasher. So I went to the book of Jasher, and in chapter 14, it gives an account of when the kings of Egypt became pharaohs. So who is this pharaoh? It says that in the days from the land of Shinar, that's where Babylon is formed, a wise man who was full of understanding and wisdom, and he was a very handsome man. He was handsome, but he was poor. And he was poverty stricken. The reading from history says, in those days there was in the land of Shinar a wise man who had understanding and all wisdom and of a beautiful appearance, but he was poor and indigent. His name was Rikayon, and he was hard set to support himself. And he resolved to go to Egypt, to Osiris, the son of Anam, king of Egypt, to show the king his wisdom, for perhaps he might find grace in his sight, to raise him up and give him maintenance. And so Rikayon did so. So here's this man from the land of Canaan, the part of the land called Shinar, which we know was part of Nimrod's Babylon kingdom. This man went to Egypt, and his intent was to go and meet the prince of the king, his son, because if he could become friends with the son, then he could get an invite to meet the king. So by the end of this chapter in this historical Jewish book of Jasher, they made Rikayon Pharaoh prefect under King Osiris. The one that was prince is now the king. And he made Rikayon Pharaoh prefect. It was a title given to the governor of Egypt. So this Rikayon Pharaoh, he governed over Egypt every day. He went out and he met with the people and he governed them every day. But the king would only go out once a year. So the people developed a rapport with this Rikayon Pharaoh. And all of the people loved Rikayon. And with his wisdom and shrewdness and cunningness, he seized the control of the government from the king. And the people made him king. The Egyptians made him king. And they made a decree that every king from now on that reigns over them would be called Pharaoh. But I didn't stop in the 14th chapter. I went on to the 15th chapter because I wanted to know about what time frame this Rikayon became Pharaoh. So in the 15th chapter of the book of Jasher, it says, and in that year, what year? the year that Rechiah became Pharaoh. In that year, there was a heavy famine throughout the land of Canaan. This is from the book of Jasher. And the inhabitants of the land could not remain on account of the famine, for it was very grievous. And Abram and all belonging to him rose and went down to Egypt on account of the famine. Now in our scripture, it tells us there was a famine in the land, and Abram, this is Genesis chapter 12, verse 10, it says, and there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down into Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was very grievous in the land. So this history book lines up with our scriptures. Because during the time that this guy became Pharaoh, in that same year, there was a famine, and Abram went into Egypt, and him and Sarah had an encounter with the Pharaoh. So during Abraham's time, that's when this Pharaoh was established in Egypt. And he was a Canaanite. He was from the land of Canaan, from the land of Canaan, from the land of Shinar. So with all of this, based on the title of Pharaoh, which was not used before until the Canaanites came in, and based on the timetables of history, world history, and then based on Jewish history references, I begin to understand that this Pharaoh was more than likely not an Egyptian, but a Canaanite. Now, I don't include Moses in this, because by the time of Moses, the Canaanites had been kicked out of Egypt. And they were dealing with an Egyptian Pharaoh. Any questions about what I said so far? Because I know I'm going sort of deep here, because this is where God took me. Did you understand how I came to the place where I believe that this Pharaoh is a Canaanite? Any questions anybody might have? So now let's go back to verse 11. It says again, and Joseph placed his father and his brethren and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. So I just want to just put all of this together with history and scripture. So before Abraham and Joseph and Jacob entered into the land of Egypt, there was a large influx of Canaanites into Egypt. They lived in the Delta, the same area where Goshen is located. And over a period of time, these Canaanites became landowners, and they formed a political coalition which gave them great power in the Delta area of Egypt. And at a weak point in Egyptian political power, the Canaanite coalition obtained a governor, a pharaoh prefect, a prime minister, that held the same, like what Jacob is now, like what Joseph is now, like Joseph is a governor. This Canaanite became like a governor in the land of Egypt. And because he was with the people daily, and the people looked at him as who to go to, eventually this prime minister, this Canaanite Pharaoh prefect, was established as the Canaanite Pharaoh, as the king of Egypt. And the name of Pharaoh was established after the Canaanites conquered Egypt in the 14th dynasty, going into the 15th dynasty of Egyptian history. So what that means is this explains a little bit better to me, at least, why this Canaanite Pharaoh would be eager to install a Hebrew slave from the land of Canaan. This family of Canaanites are from Canaan. And here is this man called Joseph, who's an Israelite. He's a slave, he's in prison, but he recognizes that this God has divine authority in his life. He's from Canaan. They've had encounters with Israelites before. So it explains why he placed Joseph to be governor, prime minister. Because in his mind, a person from the land of Canaan could be more trusted than the native Egyptians, because these Egyptians were conquered by the Canaanites. So why not put another foreigner as second in command in the land of Egypt? That's what happened, and what I believe happened. The Pharaoh is a Canaanite, and Joseph is a Hebrew. Again, when we look at history, world history, Jewish history, and we look at scripture, because it only uses the word Pharaoh, it tells me that there are two foreigners right now in power in Egypt. The Pharaoh himself and the second in command, which is Joseph, who is the governor, prime minister of Egypt. So in verse 11, I'm going to read it one more time. And Joseph placed his father and his brethren and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded. Again, this is the only time in scripture the land of Ramses is mentioned, which took me on this whole study that I had to do and finish up this morning. Now, this is really, in the days of Moses, it's called the land of Ramses, but during this time, it's called Goshen. So now I want to go back to some earlier scriptures in Genesis 47, because now my perspective is a little bit different about who these two people are, and how they're interacting with one another. Let me get to my notes, excuse me, please. Okay, so when you go back to verse 1 in Genesis 47, and when I look at the history books, they match. No difference. Joseph came to Pharaoh, said, my father and brethren are here with their flocks and their herds. Only difference is in the Jewish history book, it's a little bit more detailed. He said that my father and my brethren are here with their sheep and all their oxen and all that they have. And they've come to the land of Canaan, and behold, they are in the land of Goshen. So all of that matches up with scripture. So I didn't have a problem with that. Then in verse 2, it says he took some of his brethren, even 5 men, and presented them unto Pharaoh. Now when Jewish, in the book of Jasher, it names who the 5 brothers were. They were Zebulun and Dan and Naphtali and Gad and Asher. So I got a little more detail when I went to Jewish history. I didn't have a problem with that. In verse 3, it says, and Pharaoh said to his brethren, what is your occupation? And they said unto Pharaoh, thy servants are shepherds, both we and also our fathers. There's no difference. It's the same thing, just about a little few words different, but it's the same thing that's stated. Then in verse 4, as the brothers kept answering Pharaoh, they said, in our scriptures it said, they said, moreover, unto Pharaoh, for to sojourn in the land are we come. For thy servants have no pasture for their flocks, for the famine is sore in the land of Canaan. Now therefore we pray thee, let thy servants dwell in the land of Goshen. What? That matches what our scripture says too. It matches in the history. But I had a little issue with that. Because in our scripture, when you go back to chapter 46, Joseph told them to just say what their occupation was. They weren't supposed to say, we want to live in the land of Goshen. They were just supposed to say, we're shepherds. That's what we do. So in both accounts, it's the same, but I had an issue because they didn't do what his brothers didn't do, what Joseph told them to do. But God is in control here, so it wasn't an issue. And then Pharaoh, in verse 5, Pharaoh spoke unto Joseph and said, your father and brother are come unto thee. Now, as I'm reading this now, knowing that he's a Canaanite Pharaoh, now this is me talking this. In my mind, it came to me, more people from the land of Canaan coming here. They're like me and mine. They're from Canaan, and they've come into Egypt. And then Pharaoh, as he spoke to him, he wasn't telling him, yes, your brother has come. That's just an observation of Pharaoh. But he's saying this because he's getting ready to lead him into the next portion of what he's about to say. He says in verse 6, the land of Egypt is before you. In the best of the land, make thy father and brethren to dwell. In the land of Goshen, let them dwell. So basically, in the heart of the famine, these Israelite foreigners are going to be given the best of the land, not the native Egyptians, but these foreigners. A foreigner just like Pharaoh. Not that they're not Canaanites, they're Israelites, but they come from the land of Canaan, just like the Hyksos, H-K-Y-S-O-S. These Canaanites came from Canaan. So now he has more people coming into the land of Canaan. And he says to them, in the best of the land, make thy father and brethren to dwell. In the land of Goshen, let them dwell. In other words, he's giving them the most fertile, the most fruitful, the best that fitted for cattle and sheep and horses and goats. It's full of pastures. The river of Nile is running through. The canals of the river are running through the land. And it's the perfect place to put and graze animals. But why did he want them there? Why did this Canaanite Pharaoh want them to be in Goshen? They're thinking that they're trying to push, they're thinking that, hey, we got what we wanted. But this Canaanite leader is also getting what he wants. Because he's pushing these people, these foreigners, these Canaanites, into a rich, fertile area during the famine. So why did he do this? Well, if you go back to verse 3, you'll read that Pharaoh said to his brothers, what is your occupation? And they said, we are shepherds. We are shepherds just like our fathers. So Pharaoh, this lets me know that Pharaoh has some flocks. He has some herds. And he knew, just like Joseph knew, that Egyptians didn't like people that were shepherds. They didn't like people that that had grazing animals. They didn't like them. For some reason, they disdained them. They were an abomination to them. And this Canaanite Pharaoh knew that, but he had flocks and he had herds. And when it comes to agriculture, the Israelite agriculture and the Canaanite agriculture are similar. They're shepherds. The Pharaoh's people were at one point shepherds. They lived in the land of Goshen, in the delta area of Egypt. And he knew that they would give better care to his sheep, to his goats, to his horses, to his oxen, than the Egyptians would. So when we go back to verse 6, the last part of that verse in chapter 47, Pharaoh says, if you know any man of activity among your brothers, make them rulers over my cattle. In other words, if you know any able men among your brothers, put them in charge of my livestock. Make them masters over my stuff. So in other words, these Israelites coming and living in Goshen is going to help him. Because now he knows his livestock is going to get the better care than they would from those who live in Egypt. Because Egyptians, yeah, they have grazing animals, but they don't like people whose occupation is just to graze and raise sheep and goats and oxen and horses. Then when we go to verse 7, which I talked about at first, Joseph brought in Jacob, his father, and set him before Pharaoh. And Jacob blessed Pharaoh. Now that I know that this is a man from Canaan, I understand better why he allowed Jacob to bless him. If you go into Exodus, Moses couldn't do nothing with that Egyptian Pharaoh. He couldn't bless him. He couldn't talk to him that good. He said, let my people go. The man said, yeah, okay, and did something different. This Canaanite, this Pharaoh is not an Egyptian. So when Jacob blessed him, he accepted the blessing. This is a situation where you have a man with political authority is being blessed with a man with divine authority. So during their discussions, with Jacob blessing Pharaoh, he is operating in divine authority. And this non-Egyptian Canaanite Pharaoh recognized the divine authority that was in the family of Jacob. He recognized it in Joseph, and he recognized it in Jacob. And Jacob blessed him coming in, and he blessed him going out. His response to the blessing was not the same as a man who would think he is a god. Any questions so far? Any questions at all? Did I lose you anywhere?
I still want to know the Ramsey part.
The Ramsey? Yeah. Okay. The land of Ramses is the name of the land of Goshen when Moses is there. In these scriptures, Moses ain't born yet. The land is not called the land of Ramses yet. It's called the land of Goshen. And that threw me for a loop, because I knew Moses wasn't there yet. They didn't call it Ramses because Ramses ain't born yet. Ramses, this is the 14th, 15th dynasty of Egypt history. Ramses ain't gonna be born until the 19th dynasty. That's what. Four more kingdoms in between. So that made me wonder, why would Moses, because we know Moses wrote the book, And Moses wrote the first 5 books of the Bible. That's what I've been taught. And he would know that during the time when they entered into Egypt, that it wouldn't be called the land of Ramses. It would be called the land of Goshen. Even when Pharaoh spoke, he said, I'm gonna let you go into the land of Goshen. He didn't say the land of Ramses. So in this particular scripture, when Moses was writing it, and I'm going to say that Moses wrote it because that's what I've been taught. When he put in the land of Ramses, it's out of historical order. But it made me go study to find out who this Pharaoh is. Because no place else would have made me study it but this one scripture. Who is this Pharaoh? We know that this land of Ramses is not happening right now. It's the land of Goshen. But Moses felt, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he felt the need to call it the land of Ramses. I've read this for many years, and it never impacted me until I had to teach on it. I know the land of Ramses is favorable commanded. I didn't have an issue with it. But as I was studying, under the inspiration that I have when I'm studying, when I saw that word, it hit me. This is out of place. Ramses is when they were being kicked out of Egypt, not when they're going into Egypt. So what is important in this scripture that made me study? It was 2 things, Ramses and Pharaoh. Those 2 were, well, 3, Ramses, Pharaoh, and Israel. What is the scripture trying to tell me? And that's when I started going through the history. That's when I found out about the Canaanites overtaking Egypt. And they ruled there for almost 300 years. Okay. That's when I kept researching and I found out that this man that became the first Pharaoh, when in the Jewish history books, is the same man that Abram met when he went to Egypt. So look at how God orchestrated this. He allowed the Canaanites to be rulers in Egypt. They were rulers when Abram was the patriarch, they were rulers when Isaac was a patriarch, and they're rulers while Jacob is a patriarch. Egyptians hate shepherds. They hate them. If it was a Pharaoh that was an Egyptian, they wouldn't have got the favor that they got as they did with this Canaanite Pharaoh, because they hate shepherds. And they would not have gotten the best part of the land. But this Pharaoh is not Egyptian. And he's trying to keep his political power. So here are some more people from Canaan. Yes, let them populate Goshen. And on top of that, my people are shepherds too. Canaanites from the land of Canaan, they were shepherds. They had oxen and sheep to go. He said, and make them the masters of my livestock too. So this is something that's going to help him. And also, when you think about it, if he lets them populate Goshen, now they're an asset to him. Because he's got more people from Canaan in the land. And if he keeps them in his favor, if the Egyptians try to take power away, more than likely they will be his allies in that instance. But this is how Pharaoh is thinking. In how I studied it out, I believe that Pharaoh was using them as a political strategy to keep power in the land of Egypt because they overthrew Egypt. And a lot of Egyptians, if somebody overtook us, we wouldn't be too happy with who's in power. We'd be looking for ways to get them out. And he knew this. So when he realized who the same Pharaoh, when he realized who Joseph was earlier in the scriptures, he didn't have no issue making him second in command. Because now you got two foreigners, one from Canaan and one's an Israelite that's in power in Egypt. So he's got people from the land of Canaan in power over Egypt. They're not his people, but they are from Canaan. They share a common place of where they grew up. Any other questions about that?
It makes you look at the political issues that we face today.
Yes, it does.
And folks are trying to, because they're not happy with the results of an election and the things that they're still trying to do.
It does relate to today. It surely does. I do not know why this stood out to me. All I knew is was something had to be found out. And when I study, I tell people, you don't have to believe what I say. Go study it for yourself. Go look up Egyptian history. Find out when they conquered Egypt. Find out when the name changed from the king of Egypt to Pharaoh's. Because of the use of Pharaoh in scripture, I truly believe that this is a Canaanite Pharaoh. I'm convinced. And I looked, and there are other people online and other places that also believe the same way I do. We don't know which Pharaoh it was. We just know it was a Canaanite Pharaoh because they were in place for 300 years. We don't know if the Israelites came in during the first 100 years or the second 100 year of their reign. But we know that they came in during their reign. When I looked at the timetables that I have of history, they came in during either the first or the second 100 years. Any other questions? I know I put a lot out there today. God had me up for a very long time because now I've got to look at it in a political perspective, and I'm not a political person. I'm just not. I don't like politics. I study enough to see who I like to vote for, and then I'm done with it, unless they get on my nerve like number 45, but that's a different story. So again, who is this Pharaoh? He's a Canaanite. He's a foreigner. He's in office. And he put Joseph as his second in command because he knew he could trust Joseph. He couldn't trust a native Egyptian. They'd be scheming, trying how to get him out of office, going through political, smiling in your face and stabbing them in the back. But Joseph is a foreigner. And Joseph is grateful for the office that this Canaanite king Pharaoh gave him. Now, I don't know if Joseph knows that he's a Canaanite. I don't know if he knows that because that people didn't even realize that Joseph himself was an Egyptian. His brothers thought he was an Egyptian. It could be that Joseph thought he was an Egyptian. And Pharaoh allowed him to think he was an Egyptian. But we don't know that. Scripture doesn't tell us that. But based on what I studied and the use of Pharaoh and world history and Jewish history, I do firmly believe that this man is a Canaanite. God, I believe God in his sovereign wisdom placed him there, knowing that this third famine was coming and that they would grant favor to his people. Now they can be birthed in grow as a nation in Egypt because they've been given the best of the land. The Pharaoh in charge gave them the best of the land so that they can grow as a nation. They can populate and grow because he wanted them to grow. He wanted to expand his territory. What better way to do it than to put some people, some foreigners in this land? A land that's good for grazing their sheep and their cattle and their horses. Any other questions, anybody?
When I was studying this, it came to me in the liking unto today, how the Pharaoh end up like owning the people.
Yes, that's further down in scripture. Yes, it is. Go ahead.
Because their hardship, they sold themselves out.
Yes, they did.
And I would say the Lord, the Holy Spirit, had me too to look at the comparison that during this hard time, number 45, as you refer to him, he started giving free money. And then it came a time when they collected or want that money back. That's even a more suppression down. And people, I remember him saying one time when he was in office, if you take my money, you're going to do what I say.
Yes, he did say
that. He was giving out money that people would elect him back in, that they would do what he said, give him more power to have over the people. But that was tangible stuff that only lasts for a minute.
Temporary.
And so we are selling ourselves out. And that was, if you look at the United States and their behavior, they give out tangible things. When the Hispanic nation came in, people, they got a lot of tangible stuff. They a house is a tangible thing. You can either take it away. They didn't get the solid power, and they bring in people that they give tangible things, like tangible jobs, tangible houses, cars, and things of that nature. But they can snatch it back and send them back or have them to do whatever. So the Lord had me doing that comparison. So I don't know where he's going to take me or how far the knowledge that he allowed me to see or what to do with it. Perhaps just to pray, I don't know. But like the two were saying, God had given me to look at that and to be careful about what money you receive at this time. Because even with the tangible stuff, and I'll wrap it up, they can take your home. You know.
Well, I won't be able to, maybe next week, we'll go through how Joseph handle the famine. Go ahead.
When you brought out the politics part of it, it has a lot of interesting, because as you move into why Moses is born and why they then become afraid of the people, that happens a lot in political sense, that they grew as a nation from 70 to over millions of them in the land of Goshen. And if the political power switched and during the time of Moses and before, then you can see you can see what you're mentioning now. We got to keep you suppressed, keep you down, if we're going to stay in power. And so that leads me to the voting rights.
Yes.
And what's happening in America. southern states that are trying to stay in power by disenfranchising others from the ability to shift the power in a nation. And so it as you're talking about the political side of it, it then gets me to thinking about what's happening now and the why to it. Because as I've been thinking about this whole piece of what's happened in Georgia, what's happening in Texas, what's happening in Florida and all of these other southern states, it's to hold on to
power.
And all of us are fighting in this sense for power that belongs to God. And the ultimate sense of this, the reason Joseph got there is because of God's power.
Yes.
The reason all of this happened is because Pharaoh believes I'm a god, and God said, no, you're not who you say you are, because there's only one God, and that's me. And how that's still manifesting itself now, that people are trying to be God, in a sense, that I am the ultimate source and the ultimate power, whether it's through politics, whether it's through business, whether it's through land, whether it's through food, because that's really what this is about now. What you're talking about is how food is used to control.
Yeah.
And so it's interesting as you fast forward, because this isn't today or yesterday celebrated the Freedom Riders. And the Freedom Riders were rioting in the South for the right to vote.
To vote.
Yeah. And we're still 60 years later
dealing with
these issues about voting rights in America. But it's all about who is going to be in power.
Power.
And that's really what you're looking at and what you're bringing out. The political side of man wanting to be in control and wanting to be in power.
So here, what we discussed today, we got political power and we got God's divine power.
Yes.
And God's divine power is still working, even in the political scene.
Mm-hmm.
So even though this Pharaoh is doing things to keep his power, God is still working through his anointing power through Joseph to make sure that things are done correctly. Well, next week, we'll probably reach or talk about how Joseph had handled the famine. And a lot of people have an issue with it, but when you think about how he did it, it's under God's control.
Yeah.
When they first, before the famine came, the people sold all the corn to Pharaoh. Now during the famine, that money was Pharaoh's money that they got when they sold the corn. So now they got to go back and buy the corn, and they're still using Pharaoh's money. So every time Joseph got something or did something, he gave it to Pharaoh, back to the man in the political power. Joseph didn't come rich through the famine. Pharaoh became rich. As you read the story, he got all the money. He got all the cattle. He got all the land. He got the people to become sharecroppers or slaves. And then when the land was getting ready to be healed, he got one-fifth of everything that they grew. So Pharaoh, okay, go ahead, Pastor.
No.
Okay, it's time. Okay. Well, I want to thank you guys for joining us today. This has been really a wonderful time of study, and I thank you for joining. And if there's anyone out there who doesn't know Jesus Christ, this is a good time to know him. It's really a powerful time to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. If you do not know him, I just pray in my heart that you get to a place where you will want to know something about Jesus. if you're someone who's wondering right now, I'd just like to have a word of prayer with you. Father God, I personally thank you because at one time I was an atheist, Lord. I didn't believe in anything. But as time and life kept pushing me down, I realized that I needed something. I needed something more tangible than what was physical. And I remember, Lord God, that my parents grew me up in the church. So I had some word, I just thought I had rejected it. But there came a time, Lord God, in my life when I realized I needed a Savior. And so, Father God, if there's someone out there right now who realizes that they need a Savior, then let them repeat these words. Thank you, Father God, for giving me Jesus Christ. I believe in him. I believe that he came into this world to restore my relationship with you. And because I believe, your word tells me that I am now saved. I believe he came. I believe he died. I believe he rose again. I believe that he did this for such a sinner such as me. And now, Lord God, you told me that once I believe, now I am your child. Now I am part of your kingdom. And now I am a believer. So, Father God, let me from now on live my life as one who believes in Jesus Christ. So thank you, Father. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you for joining, and may God bless you.